Toussaint Egan is not here today, so in his place we put the Venom poster that I got for free outside of...
Yeah, this feels a little racist.
Outside of the screening of Venom, this is not supposed to... Oh my god! No! We're a Snatch family.
I just recorded that. So
yeah, I was
going to
say, we should put that on a t-shirt. I think the guy at the barbershop hates me because I've only been to the barbershop.
Because you ask him repeatedly if he can get the booster seat for you at the chair.
No, because I asked for a blowjob.
Welcome into Film Tank, the weekly podcast that covers both new and classic cinema. On this episode of Film Tank, we discuss the new Sony Marvel film, which is Venom, starring Tom Hardy.
Sony!
If you would like to get in touch with Film Tank, you can always email us at filmtankshow@gmail.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Film Tank Show. And you can listen to all of our episodes on our website, filmtankshow.com, or on iTunes. And now, here are your hosts, Nick Cheney, Toussaint Egan, and myself, Alex Diekman. Hello there again, everybody, and welcome into episode 170 of Film Tank. I am Alex Diekman, along with not Toussaint Egan, but just Nick Cheney.
I wouldn't say just. I would say that not Toussaint Egan, but we have someone better. Maybe that's what I would say.
Nick Cheney?
Yeah, that's me. Yeah. Hey.
I was going to get to our guest, but that's okay. Thank you for just totally taking that from me.
I didn't talk about the guest.
You didn't, but you were going to.
No, I said not Toussaint Egan, but someone better, me.
Okay.
I was not even thinking about our guest. No offense, guest.
No offense, guest.
Well, I'm trying not to say who the guest was, because apparently that's a big issue with you.
So our guest, who needs a haircut, her name is Anna Bodizadu, and she is here, and the haircut thing is kind of a running joke, so yeah. If you don't get it, I probably
Fuck
won't
you.
Get it when we're listening back to this episode either. So, Anna, welcome back.
What was your last name? Anna Boda Hairdo?
Boda Hairdo?
That would be a terrible... Boda
hairdo.
Boda
hairdo. That would be
a terrible
you were
saying,
last name.
Bodizadu, so I was like...
That is her name.
I know. So I changed it to fit with this running joke that our audience is not privy to.
Thank you again for welcoming me back. It is so lovely to be back here.
I was going
to
say, we let you come in with that haircut, so...
I know, yeah. Sure. Fuck me, right? Stupid haircut.
No comment.
Oh, that was good. So today, on this episode without Toussaint...
I say that at work too many times. Fuck me.
Yeah.
Like, never to someone I shouldn't say, but probably not to people that appreciate it.
Okay. Like, now, so here's the only thing. I feel like, because of our amazing American English language, at some point, somebody's going to be like...
Yeah.
Hey. And
well,
it's gonna
maybe.
Be like some 70-year-old.
That's the only reason why I'm saying it. I just want someone to misconstrue what I'm saying. No, but I'm genuinely. I'll be sitting at my desk, and you know, someone who I'm at least friends with will be like, "Oh, did you do this or whatever?" And I'll be like, "Oh, no, I didn't. I'll do that now." I'm like, "Okay, well, we need it by whatever." And I'll be like, "Oh, okay, cool. So fuck me, right? Like, my feelings don't matter in this equation."
So when I'm at work, I'm constantly swearing to myself at Excel spreadsheets, and I don't really like sit quote unquote next to anybody, but I share a cubicle wall with somebody right next to me, and I always wonder, like, can she hear me just being like fuck 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 over and over again? And then one day she was like, Anna, do you hear me talking to myself? I'm like, actually, I don't. And I'm like, oh, okay, well, I swear to myself like all day, so just so you know.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
my workplace is an absolute fucking zoo, so it is like...
Well, maybe Matt Damon will buy it.
Nick 2012 called, they're literally right there and they would like to take you back.
Why? We bought a zoo camera.
First of all,
like
we
2016?
Broke up like 6 years ago.
It did not come out
no,
in 2016.
It came out when I was young. I mean, not young, but...
It came out at least 5 years ago.
Yeah, it was definitely a while
Whatever ago. Year that movie came out, it wants you back.
Oh, 2011.
Yeah.
Fuck. I was
I'm
so
thinking
close.
About The Zookeeper.
Yeah, what do you know? Absolutely not. Cameron Crowe, baby.
Sorry. Did he cast any white people in Asian roles in that one?
No, but... Some of the animals were not the right ethnicity.
So, I don't want this opportunity to be missed. Toussaint Egan is not here today, so in his, place we put the Venom poster that I got for free outside
of... Yeah, this feels a little racist. Outside
of the screening of Venom, this is not supposed to... Oh my god! No! No, it's just, it's supposed to take it. It's just sitting in the chair. God damn this.
No,
see Toussaint.
It is funny because I'm sure if he saw it, which he said he was going to be taking a hardline stance against seeing it, especially since he wasn't going to be on the episode.
Wait, did he go see it at all?
He did not. I think he's going to try not to. Mm. So he was saying he thought he would not like it, and I probably would agree with that. So I think he would feel even worse knowing that the poster of Venom is sitting in his seat. So,
well, we just needed to fill this.
See, if we wanted to make this feel more authentic, we would have a cell phone in front of it and not contributing anything to the podcast. So,
oh, come on.
There
oh,
it is. Perfect. He's on Twitter. Tui. We miss you, bud. We know you're not listening to this.
He'll listen to it, though.
No, he won't.
Sure he will.
Okay.
Okay, so then let's... You guys... I mean, technically, if he's not going to listen to it, doesn't that mean we can just say whatever? I'm just kidding.
Oh, no, we can do that okay. he was.
We do that when he's here.
Okay.
So. All right. I think it's mostly
if anything,
fine.
He'll listen to this episode more than he would an episode that
he's... actually might be true.
On, so.
Yeah.
Hey, buddy.
How's it going out there?
Alex is waving.
I am. When we first started this, we broached the idea of having like a webcam in here. And that got shown the door quickly because ain't no one got time for that shit.
Mm-mm.
So people don't listen to our podcast, let alone watch us do it. So, yeah. So today we are discussing... Ooh, Nick is enjoying some fine Coca-Cola here.
Drinking it, he's literally drinking it like it's whiskey. Literally.
What do you mean like? It's from the same family.
It's great. I just imagine you opening up the can and being like, aged 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Expiration dates, more like a proclamation date.
Okay. So, we are going to be talking about the Sony released film, which is Venom.
Venom!
Venom!
That's my Eminem. Excuse me. Eminem impression.
Yeah, that was one heck of a song, right?
Sure was. Now streaming on his new album, Kamikaze.
Awesome.
That is actually it. Yeah.
At the end. Yeah, that's fine. So, the film surrounds Eddie Brock as he acquires the powers of a symbiote, and he will have to release his alter ego, Venom, to save his life.
I don't know that it's an alter ego.
That's what IMDb says.
Wow. Oh, IMDb is not doing a great job. Like, whenever I hear you read a synopsis, I'm like, oh, that's close, but even in a paragraph, they could have done better.
So, the film, directed by Ruben Fleischer, who previously has done Zombieland, and also...
Gangster Squad.
Gangster Squad, yeah, that was the one I was going to get to.
30 minutes or less.
Yeah.
That's all I got.
Okay. And the stars, Tom Hardy as Eddie Brock, slash Venom, his alter ego. Also, Michelle Williams, Riz Ahmed, Jenny Slate, and really, that's about it. So,
Woody Harrelson?
I was going to say we'll get to that, but that's okay. The post credit scene was
I'm only
amazing.
Ruining it because it's one of the worst things I've ever seen.
Well, first of all, so was he supposed to have Ronald McDonald's hair?
Oh.
So here's the thing. I'm not as up to date on Marvel Comics as I am, at least now, DC. So I Googled Carnage, well, in this case, Eddie, whatever his last name is, to see. And certainly he has red hair in all the pictures I found, but no, none of it made him look like a pedophile clown.
That way was really bad. I just want to say something that Toussaint had mentioned before this episode that I don't want to forget to mention because I think we should at least talk about the comic book a little bit.
Okay.
And both of you gentlemen saw this too because it was in the group message. Mm-hmm. So Toussaint said that the symbiote costume was first introduced, the symbiote costume for Venom was first introduced in the issue number 8 of the Marvel crossover event Secret Wars, after the idea was originally submitted by a fan solicitation contest hosted by Marvel in the early 80s. So what that means is that Marvel took the inspiration from a fan?
That's how you do it.
Is that... That's what I'm... understanding, right? Is that how you guys are understanding it?
Yeah, my thought is that that's a cute way of them saying, we have no ideas, please give us some.
Very good point. Okay, but yeah, I just wanted to mention that fun fact, so.
Yeah, that is very interesting. That kind of thing is not that uncommon, or at least at that time period. I mean, a lot of places reached out to the public. Especially, it's so easy to forget now, but without social media / the internet, it was really hard for people to connect to their audience. So having things like that. What?
No, I'm laughing about something I'm going to bring up.
Okay. Anyways, I was just saying that I feel like
this is important.
The connection to the audience, that type thing, was somewhat prevalent, but what you just described sounds just blatantly like, you guys have cooler ideas than us, right? You do! Good! Here's no money.
Yeah, bum.
So the reason why the Carnage post-credit scene made me giggle very hard is because if either one of you watched MTV's The State, which was in the 90s, it was a sketch show with a troupe of 11 comedians who a lot of people know today but didn't know back then. Joe Atrulio, Michael Ian Black, that whole gang. They made the movie Role Models and whatnot. Well, anyway, there's a very great sketch in there where Michael Showalter plays a character named Blueberry Johnson, who is this... Who, first of all, the sketch is great. Everyone should Google it. Where he plays.
I feel like you could get slapped in the face with something that isn't that clip if you search for that.
That's true. So, Blueberry Johnson, you don't need context for this, but I'm going to say it anyway, is a guy who looks like how he does in Google image search, and I'm about to show you what he looks like, who basically wants to do a children's show because he's perfect. Like, he's got a squeaky voice, and he looks whatever, and like the executives are just quote-unquote not seeing it, and that's like the joke. And he gets more and more pissed off. By the end, he says, I look like a fucking blueberry. So, Carnage looks like the nightmare inverse version of Blueberry Johnson.
Yes, he does.
Yeah, that hair is... Like, seriously, the way I felt about the hair is, like, they only had Woody Harrelson for about 3 hours that day.
Yeah.
And they didn't get the right hairpiece, and they did not have time to redo it.
Fuck it, we'll wig it.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I imagine that's how it went down.
Yeah. It seems like they probably did the same thing with Michelle Williams' wig, if we're being honest.
Oh, come on. That wasn't that bad.
I know a bad wig when I see one.
Oh, Michelle. How you like that?
I'm sure she's a nice lady in real life.
Why do we have to say that about people? I'm not saying about you, but I'm saying that in general.
But I'm calling you out.
Because I don't want to, like, first of all, it's not her fault that she has a shitty wig.
It's not, but why should we just assume that people are nice people? I think the last year of Hollywood has shown us that most people in Hollywood are bad.
So here's what I'll say about, in rebuttal to what you're saying. Mm-hmm. We live in a land where you're innocent until proven guilty. And yet you want to take these people. You want to put them up in the stockades. And you want to crucify them.
Mm-hmm.
Shame on you.
Yep.
And shame on America.
Is that your Orrin Hatch?
No, I believe he was going for Brett Kavanaugh.
I'm sorry.
I feel like it was a little bit of a homogram of everybody who was complicit that day.
So 2 days ago.
But, you know, we really gave him, you know, a really hard time. So we should all forgive him or ask for his forgiveness.
I mean, he did have that calendar that showed he worked out with his friend Tobin.
My favorite thing about that calendar is, like, if you're a lawyer, which I don't know anything about the Supreme Justice Court.
I mean, Nick isn't a lawyer. Like, nobody here is. No. Disclaimer.
Disclaimer, yes. But I feel like you should know a thing or two about how to try a case or so. And if I was a lawyer, which I should be, but I'm not. But if I was...
You don't have the patience to go to school for that.
No.
No.
Nope. I feel like I would be like, Brett, do you have any evidence that would dispute these claims? Absolutely. I've got this calendar that basically puts me right exactly where she said I was with the exact same people that she said was there. I'd be like, Brett, no. No, burn that. No. I mean, obviously, we live in a country where, you know, like, the closer we are to a truth, the harder we will just pretend like it's not the truth, whatever. So fuck
yeah,
me, right?
I don't know. And I did not mean to be an asshole, by the way, if I came off that way about your comment, but
by assuming Michelle Williams
but
is
assuming
a nice person.
That
no, it's okay.
Everybody is a nice person is just kind of like, eh, whatever.
No, I feel like you're right. I mean, maybe I'm just maybe
I say it too, so it's not it's just something that the last time I said that, I thought about it, and I was like, maybe they're not a nice person.
Right.
I mean, maybe
they're not, but why should we,
No, but why should we have to say that, oh, I'm sure they're a nice person, but that wig looked like shit.
I feel like maybe it's just very human to give the benefit of the
doubt
to people that we don't know. Like, I'm sure people gave the benefit of the doubt to Harvey Weinstein. So
for a long time.
For a very long time, that's what they did. But, I mean, that's neither here nor there. That can be applied to a slew of many others.
Sure.
So
it is just the nice and polite thing to say.
Right.
And you are right, and I should stop being a dick.
No.
No, but for real, though.
I assume you're a nice person, though.
No. You know me too well, so. So who wants to lead off on Venom?
I will.
Okay.
Nick does.
Nick and his glass of Coca-Cola are
I knew
ready.
Nick was going to start this off, because look at how indignant he looks with his glass of Coca-Cola.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me.
Okay. That felt like a fucking, like, weird Tom Green sketch. I don't know what that was.
First of all, if you're intending that as an insult, I do not take it as such. You put me on TV, I will fuck a moose. Actually, I don't even need to be on TV.
Man, this feels like an old school film tank episode here. I gotta tell you,
I should put out there that I have not fucked moose in at least.
I've not fucked moose or moosin.
Would it be mice?
No, that's a
meese.
That who's got the Brian Regan who does a whole thing about.
Oh yeah, about spelling.
Just about
the caboose. Like whatever.
Well, I think this one was about the plural term.
The geese. And then he goes, what do you call? His teacher's like, Brian, what do you do for a moose? And then he's like...
Moosin.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I literally just listened to that because I have not listened to Brian Regan in forever, but it came up on Random as one of my albums. And that's very random.
Yeah.
Like a week ago, I would have no idea what you're talking about.
But here you are. You got the context.
Anyway.
Beautiful. So, Venom.
Venom. So... I'm sorry. Like, oh boy, I need another drink. this movie exists. It feel like it's not a disaster. that some people thought it was going to be or claim that it is. I mean, it's competent as far as, like, the way it's shot. And I actually did not mind some of the set pieces for action. Like, I got a tickle out of some of the combat sequences and whatnot. Overall, though, it's certainly not good. It's very baseline mediocre. And that's ultimately why a movie like this will just kind of fail in a movie where, like, maybe a Spider-Man would get away with certain things. Like, if you are going out of your way to make a quote-unquote Venom movie where you are centering your story around, I guess, an anti-hero type character, you can't just do the same formula that works for a true and tried hero, in my opinion. You have to actually, I don't know, have some more character details. And because if you waste your time on exposition, where we're probably only going to get one of these. I mean, we're probably going to get another one, but in general, this is not going to kickstart a Spider-Man universe like they think it
will. God, I hope not.
No, I don't think it will. It's just such a waste of time by the end of it. And I think that's ultimately what this movie was. It's like, I didn't mind it while I was watching it, to be completely honest. Mm-hmm. But definitely, do I wish I would have seen a different movie in its place? Probably. It just kind of works. It's just kind of there. Mm-hmm. I thought, once again, I'm continually baffled by Tom Hardy's appeal. It just never worked for me. And I should be all up in that because he's goofy and he's weird and, like, even simple line can be kind of, like, he's not like Nicolas Cage level or anything like that, but he seemed like if he took the right turns in his career, he would turn into that kind of actor.
Yeah.
And cult status, but he, I don't think he ever will because he's, I don't know, just.
It's weird because he doesn't do many British roles, and it seems like his talent skill would be good for British comedy, and yet he almost exclusively plays Americans in films.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, I really don't have any thoughts on this movie, and I think that's kind of the most damning thing I could say about it, is that it is not bad enough where I want to sit here and pick it apart to death, though I certainly have some things, whatever.
It's also not really fun bad throughout either.
No.
Which is kind of what I was hoping this was going to be.
Yeah, I mean, that would have been nice.
Yeah.
So, overall, I would say that this is not the disaster that it could have been, but in some ways that would have been better than what we got.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I think that this, even though I thought this was a very mediocre, middle-of-the-road movie, this is just not that good. And even though some people out there on the internet are taking offense, they're not taking offense, they're taking offense.
Well, since we weren't able to do the wall, they figured fence.
I was going to say, you know, we've already got that, but, you know, it's fine. That's not going to do much. Anyways, people are taking offense to the comparisons to the Fantastic Four films that have been made. And I actually think that's a pretty fair comparison, in my opinion. This is a very mediocre film with a very, boring story. So, I don't really see how it couldn't be anything else other than compared to something like the Fantastic Four, which just had a very throwaway story in each one of the movies that got made, which there were three.
Are you talking about the Fantastic Four as a large property on cinema, or are you talking about a specific one?
No, I'm talking mostly about the first two and not the Josh Trank version.
Gotcha.
Which I have never seen and I really don't plan to. Which actually, that for the most part, is a disaster from what most people have talked about. But the Fantastic Four films that came out in the early 2000s were very vanilla.
Yeah. But I strongly believe if that same cast, crew, whatever, I mean, literally, Chris Evans
became a superhero star.
But know. If that film had just come out later, after, like, an Iron Man, you know, after the MCU kind of showed what the template, quote-unquote, should be, and I say that with quotes, it was just a victim of, you know, being in that weird stasis where you either had to have a Sam Raimi-esque director behind the helm to, like, give it all its love and attention, whatnot, for mm-hmm. Spider-Man. Or you just had to be there first, like X-Men, which I really, really enjoy the very first X-Men. In fact, I enjoy most of the X-Men movies, as I've said. But I also would be lying if I said that first movie was probably not very good of a film. Like, half of that is because I watched it in 1999 or whatever the year it was when I was a kid. And mm-hmm. it's kind of like your Batman as far as, like, that was, like, one of the first things you remember watching and whatnot. Sure. That was my first exposure to anything superhero. So, mm-hmm. But was it a great movie? It'd be hard for me to truly extricate myself from that kind of discourse. Anyway.
So in Venom, though, Tom Hardy's Eddie Brock character I actually didn't think was that bad. I actually quite enjoyed a lot of the inner monologue, inner dialogue, whatever you want to call it, with him and the Venom symbiote that lives inside his body. I actually think that was a wasted part of the film because I think there could have been a lot more to that, and it could have made the film a lot better. And it just decided to instead spend the entire film on this just stupid Bond storyline with Riz Ahmed, who really kind of felt like he actually didn't want to be in this film. And I could understand why, because that storyline was so... to use a word that term that Toussaint uses all the time, it was so basic. Like, it's just, you know, this guy's like, we're going to have the symbiotes and we're going to take over and everything's going to be great. I've got no plan, but I'm a genius. And it's like, okay. So why are you killing homeless people?
Weirdly evil instead of coherently evil. For example, I don't buy for a minute that someone of his egocentrism would cut off the interview when Eddie Brock starts asking those quote-unquote hard-hitting questions. I think of him more like a person who would just start straight-up lying.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, but he literally says it's fake news
you
at one point.
You seem more guilty by cutting off the interview.
Right. And I don't... If he's supposed to be a genius, I genuinely thought he would have been like, you know, I'm glad you asked that, because mm-hmm. actually, studies show, even if those studies are bullshit, like, we're living in that day and age where we need more villains like that anyway, because that's actually more akin to the evil that's happening than being...
I agree.
So...
I actually, his villain role, and you're actually probably going to completely disagree with me on this one, Nick, but he reminded me a lot, and I'm going to look up his name because I can't type, and I was going to have this ready, and I just was terrible. His villain character reminded me a lot of the villain in the second Daniel Craig Bond film, Quantum of Solace, Dominic Green, played by Matthew Almerich. Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if I agree or disagree.
Yeah, just a very throwaway, useless villain who is supposed to be this genius, but is really just a dumbass.
I would agree, basically, except that this movie doesn't have Matthew Almerich. and that sounds bad, but
there was this one part though with Riz Ahmed that I was completely tickled with, that was cute.
I was trying to tickle him.
Yeah, that's great.
Oh, I like that.
She's thank
like,
you.
Oh,
she's
thank
into
you.
It.
Yeah,
come here, you.
God. When he, for whatever reason, is like right before he has this big interview, he's doing this walkthrough with this children's group through the place. By the way, do they hide the homeless people when they bring regular people in? How does that work?
Well, they explain to them that these are not citizens.
I think the kid exhibit was before they started bringing in the homeless people, actually.
I do not believe so.
No, they make a comment. This has been going on. Not the symbiote part of it, but the trials and tribulations.
And actually, myself and Nick discussed this a little bit, and I mentioned to him that early on in the...
Eddie Brock report.
Yeah, kind of rushed, but I actually thought pretty well done. Eddie Brock kind of 35-second breeze through to tell you who he is as a person. It does... One of his journalist things was him reporting on how all these homeless people are going missing in the city.
That's... Yes. Okay.
So...
Yes.
At any rate, So when the girl asks a question and she gets shushed by her teacher and he says, don't ever take that. You should never be shushed. And then he doesn't let her ask her question.
Yeah. He tells
his assistant that she'll answer.
Like the other doctor.
That's really considerate.
No,
actually, I thought that was going to be a plot hole until they added that line. And I was like, oh.
Yeah.
Like, this is weirdly, I don't know.
Anyway. Yeah. So that was bizarre, and the whole villain character in this was also very odd.
He had a thing about children, though. He asked Jenny Slate how her children were doing.
God, that Jenny Slate character. Oh,
I felt
boy.
Bad for her.
I felt bad for her, too. I didn't like her fate at all.
Well, I felt bad for her as an actress, because I enjoy Jenny Slate. And here she was.
She was not casted to be Jenny Slate.
No, and that's fine. Like, it's not like I was like waiting for her to go, well.
She French Rusher?
What? Well, she has a very.
She can do that voice pretty easily.
Yeah, she's got a whiny. No, I'm saying that's her shtick.
That's her thing, yeah.
And I like her. Like, you don't like her and whatnot. I meant, like, in the general sense. You thought Obvious
I did not
Child.
Like the one movie that she was in that she starred in.
Okay, but that movie,
Obvious
she was
Child.
Kind of playing a version of herself as far as comedic.
That sucks.
I'm just saying, like, literally, she was doing stand-up in the movie.
I've liked her performances in the two other roles I've seen her in.
Okay.
So.
Anyway.
So, just closing up my opening thoughts on this. It's very mediocre, but I actually did think Tom Hardy was actually pretty good in this. And I did like most of the fight scenes. And although the CGI was a little bad, which I actually am kind of okay with now, just because of seeing what the film is and the storyline they were going for, I'm good with it being a little silly looking. I actually very much enjoyed the chase scene. I actually thought it was quite delightful, which I'm usually a stickler for chase scenes because I think they can be very mundane. But this one actually I thought was pretty good. And actually the scene in the restaurant was so ridiculous and I fucking loved it. So I was going to say that. When he's like peeking with Venom like growing inside
when he
him.
Gets inside the lobster tank.
Yes. I actually thought that was fantastic. He just starts eating the live lobster and everybody is getting angry. He at one part starts choking that doctor who's that's just oof. I don't know. I loved it.
The guy from Veep.
Yeah. The guy from Veep, who in this movie is also named Dan.
Yeah. I
thought that was a little too just...
What the hell?
Exactly.
I mean, he does look like a Dan.
He does look like a Dan.
I do also like that he and Michelle Williams' character thought that they were being so cool by locking the symbiote in the MRI room, but forgot that there was an air vent. So...
Well,
was
how
great.
Were they supposed to know?
See, you know what though? That's what was actually good about it.
Yeah.
Because they thought, oh, we've got this, and then it's like, ha ha, shapeshifting.
Exactly. Yeah.
So really quickly, before we even get, I want to ask one random question. Genuinely step me through what you visualize as what happened from the moment the dog exchanged the symbiote with Michelle Williams' character. Do you think it was similar to how she passed it on back to Eddie Brock?
I actually kind of do.
Oh. Like, oh, give me a little kissy kissy, and then like... like that?
Jesus, why does she sound like Daffy Duck there at the end?
Why doesn't she?
I will say, for a film that was a stickler early on about how most people...
You love that word.
What's that?
I said you love that word.
That's, it's a good word.
Yeah.
It's the name of the syndrome that I have.
Is it really?
Stickler syndrome.
Oh, okay. Well, I will continue using that word because, as Nick has just said, I like it. The film was making a stink. Thank you, buddy. Making a stink about how most people cannot accept this into their body. Yet every single person who is in the film who comes in contact with it after the first 30
well,
minutes...
Well, I just think homeless people can't handle it. They don't have the money, and the resources.
But that dog, though.
Yeah, that dog.
Well, yeah, that dog was well taken care of. He was living life in a fucking hospital, man.
To seriously answer your question, Nick, like, Michelle Williams' character could visually see what was going on with that dog, so I bet she was just like... fine, I'll hold you. And then Venom was like, ha ha! And that's what happened.
I just wish we could have saw that.
Yeah. I'm glad that we didn't, though.
Well, I mean, I know that they were going for not necessarily a twist, but like, who's this Venom with boobs? But no, seriously. That
was a character. She Venom.
She Venom.
Oh, that's her character.
Yeah, she's like a real character in the comic.
As I was telling Nick, there are 21 symbiotes in the Marvel comic universe, so this could really turn into a whole thing, which, God, please don't.
Yeah.
Please don't. One more film and out.
Sure.
So, Anna.
Yes.
I am going to guess that we're going to go 3 for 3 here on us not loving this.
And you're correct.
Yes.
Forgive me, Nick. I had to run to the ladies' room during your starting points. Okay.
And now the whole audience knows, so there you go.
I mean, I did have half a beer, so...
Yeah. Hey, she had to go fix her hair.
First of all, the audience already knew. We have the microphone in there, too.
So I just pretty much... I agree with both of you guys. I thought...
that Matt Lauer's bathroom?
Oh, my God. Ew.
I'm sorry. It was the way he said it. It was just creepy.
Oh, my God.
No, you made it creepy.
You made it creepy. You said it.
No,
fucker.
I said a hilarious joke that was clean.
No, it
and
was not.
Adorable.
You said that we put a microphone in the bathroom.
Yeah. Try to make that weird.
I did, obviously.
Okay, you know what? I'm unlocking the door. Get out of here.
Every time I start.
God damn it.
Every time I start to talk, I get interrupted, for the record.
That's what we do on this podcast.
But not anymore.
Okay. So I pretty much agree with both of you guys. I thought this film, for lack of a better word, was mediocre. When the trailer came out, I mean, I was intrigued, but I normally get like very excited when something like this is about to come out, and I did not feel that same degree of excitement. And then I also know very, very little about the Venom character. My frame of reference, I don't believe this has been brought up yet, but my frame of reference for Eddie Brock is Topher Grace in Spider-Man 3.
That's probably most people's.
Exactly. That's most people's. And we all know Spider-Man 3, there was a lot of issues with that movie. It was generally very bad. And then we see just a little bit of Venom, and then that's kind of it. Here we get an entire movie about Venom. And I was very confused as to why, you know, it was Tom Hardy. And there was a lot of hype about him being in this movie because, like, he has a huge fan base. Lots of people really like him. Overall, I just didn't think this movie was very good. I thought the very beginning, like, the first half an hour, most of the first act just was very rushed. I thought the background of the characters was very rushed. I thought Michelle Williams' character was just, she got the worst lines of the movie, and like, there's only so much you can do with like how fucking bad most of the script really was.
See, women can play too. God damn it.
I mean, that's...
Somebody thought they were genius for writing that,
exactly.
Too.
Somebody thought they were having a really good day. So, I mean, like you guys pointed out, the villain, Riz Ahmed, just wasn't very good. Like, even his outfit, like the best part was his, you know, Silicon Valley douche bro outfit with, like, his sport coat and then the zip-up underneath. No one wears that. Absolutely nobody does. And then also the gym shoes. Can't forget that. I thought the action scenes were really good. I thought the CGI was worth it to see in theaters, which is why I'm happy that I did see it in theaters.
I thought it was very interesting that there were almost no, in fact, I guess there was one minor moment, but there were almost no Venom moments during the daytime.
That's a very good point. Aside from the very end, but we don't really see Venom.
Right.
We just kind of hear
it's
him.
It's a kind of a minor thing.
Yeah.
There at the end.
No, that's a really good point.
Which CGI-wise is probably a good thing.
Yeah.
But at the same time, though, it is interesting that he becomes almost like a Batman creature of the night type thing.
Exactly. As far as Venom the character goes, I do agree with both of you guys that like the most entertaining part was Tom Hardy and the Venom like rapport between them. I did kind of liked how that one quote-unquote personality trait that they gave him is that he now loves tater tots. I feel like that...
Tater tots and chocolate.
Exactly, tater tots and chocolate. That probably didn't come from the comics. They just kind of put it in as something for people to remember from the movie. But yeah, overall...
People eat the weirdest shit. Like, I'm the pickiest eater, so like everything is just baffling to me. But yesterday, sorry to get off on a tangent, but bringing up weird food...
Tater tots is not weird food.
No, tater tots and chocolate, like...
Well, yeah, I guess Venom likes those two things together.
Right, okay. Yeah. Well, yesterday, I literally saw something that made me gag. I watched the first Annabelle movie.
Okay.
Conjuring Creepy Doll, which I actually did not dislike.
Okay.
Okay.
Anyway, there's a scene in there where a pregnant lady's got cravings, and she takes pickles, like, out of a jar of pickles,
mm-hmm.
and dips them in mustard.
That doesn't sound very bad. That's just
that sounds disgusting.
That just sounds like a part of what you would put on a hot dog. No, minus the hot dog.
I wouldn't do that.
Sounds like something you would have on a pretty standard sandwich.
Yeah, I don't think that's weird.
Well,
pregnant women.
Fuck me, right?
Nick, pregnant women eat weirder stuff.
Nick doesn't like ice cream, so
that is true. No, but seriously, pickles.
I know
pickles and mustard are probably. Like, two things that if you put it on a burger, I can't eat the burger until you make me a new burger. Like, I like onions, tomatoes, whatever. Like, I don't want them, but I can just either eat them or pick some off.
They've saturated the burger.
Right.
They ruined it.
Yes, but pickles and onions completely alter the pickle and mustard, completely alter the entire dynamic of a burger. And the only time I can tolerate pickle anything is I've... was taught that pickle juice makes very good shot chasers, and it does, which is weird, because I thought I was going to gag.
I didn't know that.
Yes, if you do a shot of tequila and then do a shot of pickle juice, it pretty much just balances out.
Probably all the citrus, like a lime. Yeah. Yeah.
It totally, totally works. I thought I was going to puke, like, before I did it, but now, like, I'd rather have a shot of pickle juice after a shot of tequila than not have one, so. Anyway.
Interesting.
But fucking...
I just not do the tequila shot.
I mean, yeah, I wouldn't
place.
Want to do it in the first place, but whenever I go to Minnesota, that's a tradition over there now, especially because they always have pickle juice. So.
Ah.
Well, Minnesota is where I got my speeding ticket, so fuck them. I'm just kidding.
I'm still surprised I've never been pulled over on my way back or to Minnesota, because once I get over to, like, Wisconsin, I'm not doing the speed limit.
No.
No.
And why should you?
And, you know, I've got Illinois plates, so I'm just expecting to be out of state and therefore, like, oh, fuck this guy.
Yep.
He put Bogoyovich in jail. I don't know why the state official cares that much about that.
Blago. That lady just wanted to be dressed nicely. Come on.
So, anyway.
Please continue.
Yeah.
Talk about tater tots and chocolate.
Yeah, so I just, that was just something, like, I don't want to say interesting, but it is a personality trait that they did add to Venom that I thought was, quote-unquote, a nice touch. As far as Tom Hardy portraying Eddie Brock, I've been told he's kind of supposed to be, like, sassy, a little more abrasive than Peter Parker, but very much still, like, a little bit off the wall.
Which they do mention that he used to work at the same place.
Yeah, but they didn't call it the Daily Bugle.
They called it the Daily Globe.
Yeah, which I thought was really stupid, yeah. But at the same time...
They don't have the rights anymore.
I guess they don't have the rights anymore. I was waiting for them to say Daily Bugle, but...
Yeah.
You have a very good point. I was like, oh, that's not it.
And if you don't have the rights
just
anymore...
Just don't say it.
Well, I was going to say, why even make this movie? I'm being dead serious. Like,
I think the
having the rights to Venom, like, if that's all you have, and I'm not saying I wanted this movie to be a part of a cinematic universe, but if you can't make a true adaptation, then what's the point?
I think the thought is that they're going to set it up, and then by the time...
Everything
they get through the next film, which is going to be the one that people actually want to see, which is the problem with superhero films in general, because you're always wanting to see the next one and not the one you're actually watching.
The second post-credits scene certainly...
I did not stay for the
good
second
for you.
Post-credits. I
you
was told...
You did not miss anything. Literally.
That's what I was told, therefore that's why
was
I was left.
It was just 5 minutes unobstructed, I believe.
Yeah, it was like a full scene.
Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse.
Which is a movie I'm actually very much looking forward to.
Me too.
While I was sitting there, while that was happening, I was like, what the fuck? What the fuck? Like, that is the lowest of the low. I've always considered all of these post-credit scenes to be just blatant advertisements for the next film. Like, to have no artistic
value. But they give
value.
You... They,
but that is just them saying, yeah, you're right.
No, I actually will... I think when it started, it was more tolerable.
Could have said meanwhile.
So, let me make sure I'm understanding. This is a featurette about Into the Spider-Verse.
Not a featurette. No, like, it's just literally just 5 minutes from the film, in the middle of the
film. Like, if you go see the movie, you have already seen that 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And it starts off by saying, meanwhile, Miles Morales is doing this. Like, it literally says that at the bumper.
Okay.
But then what you're seeing is clearly an actual scene just excised from the movie.
That is...
And yeah, that was awful.
Yeah. Like,
and are we to believe that now this is a shared universe, this cartoon world, and this is one of the Spider-Verse?
I don't think so.
It depends on who owns into the Spider-Verse, which I
it's
assume...
It's Sony, because that's Sony DreamWorks.
Yeah. That is just blatant advertising.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And like the early Marvel post-credit scenes... were like getting people's beak wet for upcoming films a little bit.
But that was because it was like,
but it was fresh then, it made sense.
It was fresh, but it was also not just fresh, but also I would say essential. Like there wasn't enough movies out there yet to like, you know, whatever. So like the fact that these movies are still using the post-credit scenes to connect to other movies. Is getting tired. Like, that's what the movie should be doing now that we have so much room to work with.
This doesn't connect that to that. This just shows you 5 minutes of a movie that has nothing to do with the film you just saw.
No, yeah. And mostly, I think in this case, I was also referring to the Carnage, which is like...
That wasn't that bad.
Yeah, it was stupid.
I know you didn't like it, but...
It's the same exact thing as what Justice League just did.
Mm-hmm.
Literally, like...
I didn't hate the Justice League one either.
I'm not saying I hated that one. I'm not even saying I hate this one. I'm just saying they're all the same fucking scene.
Yeah.
It's literally him walking towards somebody who should be in a jail cell. In this case, they are in the jail cell. In Justice League, he wasn't in the jail cell. But mm-hmm. I'm just saying, like, they have no creativity anymore. And like, I miss the days when, like, there could have been... Like, this is a horrible one, but at least I was like, what the fuck is happening when I watched it, which is the one at the end of something where they, in Marvel, where they introduce...
Is it Adam?
No.
Sorry.
Oh, that was not. It was in the Adam Warlock one, which was at the end of Guardians 2.
Yeah.
You're talking about the Quicksilver.
Yes.
And
and I feel like that was probably a genuine surprise.
Scarlet Witch.
As to
was
like,
that
this is coming.
The end of one of the Captain Americas.
I think that was
the
end
Winter
of the
Soldier.
Winter Soldier.
Yes.
Okay.
And
yes.
So I don't think anyone watched that end credit scene and was like. Carnage is gonna be in this. Oh my god!
I actually disagree with you because I actually think people did think that.
But that's the thing is that I am me,
and they're fucking stupid.
Because here's the thing, Carnage is pretty much just Venom, but with hair.
So then why wouldn't they think that that?
But being red.
Because.
So they were so surprised that they would choose the one person who's the biggest knockoff of the character they're already following.
Have you ever fucking met superhero people, dude?
No, I have, but I'm saying, like, you don't see a difference between introducing somebody like Carnage who has enough name recognition that even I knew what he was talking about, whereas a difference of something of that and, like, Marvel saying, here's two X-Men that you didn't realize were even going to be in this.
I would agree with
shared
you
universe.
If it wasn't a prominent actor or actress. Since it was Woody Harrelson, it pretty much worked for me.
But then that's what made it even whatever, because the moment you saw him, you're like, okay, clearly he's... I mean, I didn't know, because I don't ever try to call this shit, so I didn't know it was Carnage until he said the word Carnage.
Mm-hmm.
But the moment he showed up, I'm like, oh, so here's our next villain for the movie. Like,
right.
I don't know. It's just...
The problem, I guess... The difference. That just... teased a film that has a chance to be a vastly superior film to the one I just watched. So I was interested in what it did. Not saying it was a great post-credit scene, and Woody Harrelson looked absolutely ridiculous.
I just wanted to say, Nick, like you, I am not very well versed in the comic book world, but as soon as Woody Harrelson said Carnage, I was like, oh, Carnage, the bad guy. So, I mean,
I didn't have to Google anything after this post-credit scene like I usually have to after right. the end of some of the Marvel ones, which, in my opinion, at least means they're doing something, I would say, relatively deep. I'm not saying that, you know, it's like they're digging in the well to, like, Condiment King or something.
I mean, it was
that. But it is funny. Still, at least, like, with them, and maybe now that I'm slightly more into the medium of comics, now that I've been reading some,
mm-hmm.
maybe now the next time I see one of these Marvel ones, I'll actually be like, oh, I want to go read an arc with that, so that way I know what they're going to talk about when the next one comes out.
It is funny, though, that you bring up the Justice League one, because it is really just a carbon copy of that.
Yeah,
yeah, especially same. Like the ending line, which should we have our own league? League? Yeah, which just blatantly talking about the Injustice League. Like, so yeah,
I wouldn't even need, even though I know even more now, but back then I didn't need to look up the League of, you know, whatever Shadows or whatever it's called.
I was really hoping you were going to say the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. That's all right.
Whatever, but Lex.
What are you talking about?
League. I didn't need to look that up to know exactly what he was talking about.
Sure.
Even if I couldn't name everybody who was on it or anything like that, I'm just like, oh, okay. And same thing here. Like, you are literally. I know you only have so much time because it's a post-credit scene, but your writing is so bland that you are basically telling me, don't even do any research. We will make sure you understand exactly what's happening by the time, you know, the next movie comes, so that way you won't even have to do any mental, you know, whatever.
It was the same person that wrote the line, girls can play bad too. So, like...
That is true. Oh, yeah, go on with your bad self.
They showed us.
Sure did.
Yeah. I like her. Okay. Thanks, Venom. Yeah, I'm much more interested in the sequel than I am in this film. Maybe that's just because I feel like there's still hope for the sequel because it hasn't gotten made yet.
Ideally, when the sequel happens, and I mean, the movie's already broken even, so at this
it'll be sooner rather than later.
Right. At this point, it's already broken even at the box office. There's no way to go, nowhere to go but up.
It'll be summer of 2020, probably.
2020, okay. Mm-hmm. So I feel like, best case scenario, they'll learn from their mistakes. Ideally, like, I believe her name was Anne. Sorry. Should have made her a little bit more memorable. she'll be just overall a better character. And then I don't know if her new boyfriend Dan is going to be in there, but he just, honestly, he was just the guy from Veep, but a doctor and not a politician.
In all honesty, she could just get sidelined in the next film. And I'm not saying she should, but what was that?
I don't want that to happen. I feel like when
I don't either, but boy, that is just becoming a new trend.
Coming back for a scene and then dying. And then that sets off Eddie Brock's.
Or, oh boy.
No, seriously.
If you want to go into Thor Ragnarok, oh, it just didn't work out. She didn't like that I was a superhero. It was like, what?
Yeah, that was some.
That was
bullshit.
Literally the entire appeal of why she liked you in the first two films.
But here's the thing: if she's not in this next movie, that's actually extremely weird, and it's kind of a.
It always is, though. But
well, I know it's always
it happens a lot.
But let me explain why to me that's even weirder than normal, because they set up a dramatic thread to untangle in that last scene,
absolutely.
Which is she said, "I'm sorry about Venom." So you're already teasing that, because I don't care if he hides Venom from, like, the government or from whatever, but that line has something to it where I'd want to see, possibly at least, a movie where that's now a thing he's hiding from the one person he's probably trying to still win back or whatever.
It would be funny if she, like, walked in and he's just got tater tots and chocolate all over his face.
We talked about
that. Eddie, are you okay?
I just wrote a scene for the next film, by the way. They're furiously...
You just wrote the only scene for the next film. Oh. The rest is going to be improvised.
they're going to have a similar contest to how they found Venom in the first place. Oh, send in your favorite potential scenes.
Jesus Christ. So
superstar.
I know you guys mentioned how, Alex, you had said you weren't a fan of Jenny Slate's character. I liked Jenny Slate's character a lot.
I did as well.
Yes, I really liked her. I thought she was definitely like a good person to move the plot forward, to reach out to Eddie Brock and let him know exactly what the fork was happening.
I didn't hate her character. I hated how swiftly she was removed from the film.
I didn't like that either. Okay, so are we all in agreement with this?
Yeah.
I was expecting to see more of her.
I thought the whole point of having her in the movie was so that way there would be dramatic tension of her working against Riz Ahmed.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I mean, obviously he was going to find out at some point.
Mm-hmm.
But then that made her whole thing, other than to get Eddie into the lab. Like, that's her only purpose.
That was the whole purpose of her character.
Which means that was just a waste of writing and casting, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that was a huge bummer, the way she was killed off.
And it wasn't, you know what, I guess I've seen way too many of these fucking movies. Since she was killed off screen, like, part of me thinks she's actually dead.
That's very much a possibility, and isn't it annoying that you just, like, kind of find yourself assuming that?
I mean...
Also,
I find it annoying that I have to assume that maybe this character isn't dead.
No, I mean it's the problem is that it's gotten to the point where it's just like, you know what we can do? It's almost like Hollywood screenwriters have just slowly just dropped down to soap opera levels where they're like, we've got six storylines that we're just gonna
reuse.
First
of all, soap operas are more competent because no, I'm dead serious. As far as when it comes to reveling in plot twists and change of power dynamics, because they have to live with certain choices for, like, episodes at a time, there's actually minutia in there because they have to stall for, like, you know, whatever. So the fact that we gloss over anything in any of these movies, like, for example, the way she's found out is really fucking boring and mundane. Like, so she works in this gazillion dollar business, tech, whatever, and she wouldn't think that there are cameras, or she did, but she just...
She uses her fucking handprint to get in.
Exactly.
I mean, you don't think there's some timestamp on that shit?
Why wouldn't she, like, try to do something sneaky? Like, it doesn't have to be an Ocean's whatever, but couldn't it have been like, oh, you know what, I lost my key, can you get me in, you know who I am? Like, that happens, maybe she disabled the camera, like, just very bare bones.
Not even
otherwise, why would she have risked it if she was that afraid? Like,
I guess I will say in that way, she clearly did not plan on this happening.
Well, she didn't plan on the Venom, whatever.
Correct.
But she doesn't think that Riz Ahmed is a crazy person. And
I think I mean, that's why she has Tom Hardy in there in the first place.
Right. So,
why not just out it herself then?
Yeah, or why even show up for work the next day? I mean, that's my big thing. Like, what does that happen? You're going to be like,
I mean, that all in all, that was just all just very meh story writing.
I did it.
Nice Jenny Slate impression.
That was even trying, actually. But yeah.
Hey, that was good. Anything else?
Nope, anybody
I'm has
done.
Anything?
I liked the fight scenes.
I did, too.
I thought the fight scenes were cool.
They were pretty good.
I thought the final fight scene could have actually been a little better. Only because like everything with them climbing up the rocket ship, we've already seen that many times, especially in something that did it way better, like Men in Black. So I would have liked something a little more original there, instead of just monsters just trying to push each other off of a rocket ship.
I didn't even mind the monster thing. What made me laugh out loud was that they lose their symbiotes at one point, basically toward the very, 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 very end of that fight. So that fight pretty much ends with them slapping each other. And I'm like, oh, this is how the final fight is going to...
Which actually, you know what, I will say that actually made sense, because at the end of the day, they're just two humans that cannot...
But I'm not watching this to be a human drama.
It only lasted for like 12 seconds.
But that was the last thing. Like,
no, it was not.
Oh, I thought it was.
The last thing was the rocket exploding.
Yeah,
the symbiotes getting burned by the fire, which is
okay,
casually
that was the last
mentioned.
Fight between those two.
Yeah, but he jumps on the rocket ship. No, it's not the last fight, because he puts the Venom suit on and then he stabs him with the thing and then... The Venom kind of walks up like the Addams Family hand to join back in his body.
It's stupid that it even happened.
I get what you're saying. And then he has the line to come back from it to say, like, the have a nice life thing while the ship explodes.
That was funny. I laughed.
I didn't like the replay of have a nice
life. As the rocket's exploding?
Yes.
Yeah, come on.
I did.
That's kind of menacing.
I did like during that last fight, it's when, I believe it's a vertical shot because we're looking down at the characters, when in slow motion you see, like, the symbiotes part from the people, so then you see, like, Tom Hardy and Riz Ahmed just kind of blatantly being thrown around, like, really slowly. I thought that was really neat. And you could, they designed Riot and Venom different enough to where you can see the difference between them, which, I mean, I know that's how they each look in the comics, but still, it was nice to see that translated on screen.
I actually was really hoping in the final scene that they were going to do something that I thought was just right there. It was a total missed opportunity, which was for both of them to go run and grab a symbiote and have it be the wrong one.
Yeah, that would have been cool.
Especially in the climactic scene, I think it would have been super like, what?
I think that, along with one other thing with the missed opportunity during the final fight, which is that when the rocket that blows up,
yes,
basically with the guy hanging onto the rocket.
Riz Ahmed is already inside the rocket.
Okay, so yeah. I think there should have been a shot that showed when he was in the rocket, what? That the camera...
Because you're going to say something ridiculous. It's
no,
great.
I'm not going to.
Oh, sure.
So as the camera pans down, which we do see Riz Ahmed in the rocket just before it's about to blow up, if just before it pans down and written on the rocket is just a big graffiti tag that says Eddie Brockett... It's not ridiculous.
How did he have time to write that?
He's a symbiote, dude. He can do whatever the hell he wants. He can literally be fighting while the back just tumor is flying out and, you know. Tumor. I mean, that's kind of how it was like. Bow.
I think in the next film, they need to have something where he gets caught having a conversation with the symbiote and they both look at the person that walks in. Because I think that'd be wonderful. Because what the fuck is going on?
Yeah.
I did like that final battle scene. I thought it looked really good. I really like the scene where he's in the whatever, like the Solarium area of the business places, where he's just pretty much just throwing people on the wall. I thought that was awesome.
Yeah,
that's when Michelle Williams walks in and is like, "Oh, okay."
Yes, with the scaffolding, like, being, that was really neat. And then Eddie Brock is like, wait, help. And she's like, you need to go to a fucking doctor.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. Get in the car.
Get in the car, I'm getting you to a doctor.
I like her. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Venom. I will say this, and, I mean, this is getting a little nerdy, but Venom is fucking huge, and I do not remember him being that big in the other film.
Can't he?
No, I don't think he was, actually. No, that's a very good point. I feel like Venom, like, in Spider-Man 3, it just kind of covered up Eddie Brock, and that's who Topher Grace was.
Because I feel like, size-wise, he kind of is like the size of the Hulk, which is a little weird.
I don't think he's as big as the Hulk.
Yeah, I thought he was... I think it's all
about perspective.
I feel like he's shorter than
the Hulk and Thanos, but he's bigger than, like, an average person.
I don't know, man. Watching that scene where he's fighting with the people in that, like, lobby area, he was basically towering over them.
Oh, I thought it was, like, his eye level was basically just above them.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree the way with Nick.
You'll have
know.
To rewatch it.
Nope.
Yeah. yeah, Nick just flipped off Tucson. What the fuck?
No, he didn't flip off Tucson. He flipped off the Venom poster in Tucson's seat.
That's what...
So, going to final ratings, I'll start us off. I gave this a 2.5 out of 5, which for me is a very low rating for a superhero film, as I am trying not to be, like, too stupid and nerdy about it, but I am a superhero fanboy for the most part. So I wanted to really like this film, but from the trailer on, I thought this was going to be very mediocre, and I was right. Tom Hardy wasn't really that bad here, I didn't think, and I'm looking forward to seeing him in the sequel, which I have actually pretty high hopes for now, because I think the idea of just having an entire film with he and Carnage battling. And at the same time, I think that storyline will be fun because it'll have a symbiote storyline and also to this idea of him not being a true hero, but also trying to be a hero, which is always kind of a fun thing to think about, which is why I really wanted Suicide Squad to be good. And that also was a disaster. So, yeah, a 2.5 out of 5 for me for Venom and a film that kind of was just there and will be gone soon enough.
I'll go next. So I'm going to give this movie a 2 out of 5 stars. I did not have pretty much any expectation. And like Alex, I am a huge fan of superhero movies, but this just did not really check off any boxes for me, other than the key points I had brought up earlier, which was the main things between Tom Hardy and Venom, like their main chemistry, and then also the special effects and the action scenes.
God, that could have been so much better.
Exactly. It could have been better, but it was still, like, good. Okay. Mm-hmm. But so many other things just were not entertaining enough for me to really like this movie. So, I mean, like Alex has mentioned, I hope that the eventual sequel will learn from this film's mistakes. I have no doubt that this movie will continue to do well at the box office, as it did have a very good opening weekend. And I just did not think overall this is very good, which, I mean, it's very disappointing to say that because I do want to like every superhero movie that I see, but unfortunately they can't be like at that caliber at all times. So yeah, 2 out of 5 for me.
I'm gonna have to continue this trend, and I give it 1.5 out of 5.
Wow. We're just slowly going down the stairs here.
Yeah. That's actually pretty good for me in the sense that these aren't really my bag, and I've seen a lot worse than this. To be,
did you like this more than Doctor Strange?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's not even a movie.
What? I loved Doctor Strange.
I liked it more the second time I saw it.
I mean, I would watch it again, but
I liked everything with his cape.
Yeah.
Yeah, his cape is pretty cool.
You can see that.
That climactic scene is terrible. It's very bad.
But, yeah. And I just didn't really care for this. I thought it was better than I thought it was going to be, but all the things I liked about it could have used much more, could have used steroids, basically. Like, I did actually like the Tom Hardy rapport with himself as Eddie and Venom, but we only really get good exchanges toward the very end of the movie, and I don't think there's any reason why that couldn't have been much earlier on in his Venom, you know, whatever. Yeah. Like, I don't think Venom just becomes funnier. I don't think it has to be organic, whatever. But anyway, I would have appreciated it if it was much more punchy, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually did think the action set pieces were pretty decent. I could see what was happening. I appreciated what was happening. But even at its best, I've seen others do it better. So that was probably the only reason why it's just not great. And the reason why, the saving grace, I would say, for me as to why I didn't really mind watching it is that it was slightly more horror-infused than I thought it was going to be. Mm-hmm. It's certainly not a horror film, but some of the moments with Venom and the symbiotes were actually bordering on jump scares, you know, not quite at that level, which it doesn't need to be. But I like the fact that this wasn't a, like, Peter Parker gets bit by a spider and be like, ooh, it's this tingling sensation, but it was treated as something that would not be okay. I did like that. In fact, I would watch, which it would never happen, but, you know, we are in this trend of, like, R-rated whatnot.
This was supposed to be R-rated.
Was it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I would have watched an R-rated version of this, not because I wanted more.
That's the rumor that's going to come out Blu-ray.
I could kind of see that. Mm-hmm. But I would say that I would be very much down for something like this that was maybe even a touch more scary. Not so that, like, every scene is some kind of, like, set piece of horror, but just kind of adding a bit more of what was already present, I think, of how, like, because Eddie shouldn't really be cool with this. I mean, I know he is by the end, which is fine, But in this journey, and this is the one movie where you can really do it, it should be fucking freaky. And while he is reacting appropriately, like he is whatever, it wasn't like the scene at the apartment where he, what do you call it?
Eats the chicken from the trash?
No, I was going to say his neighbor plays the guitar too loud. Like,
oh.
That could have been even more kind of terrifying.
Yeah.
I mean, because he makes a scary face. But I felt like moments like that were when this could have actually used maybe an R rating, where we could have had something that was like even more, like, I don't know, disgusting or whatever. But I'm rambling. It's 1.5 out of 5.
I will say you had mentioned this, and I'll kind of just let you take the wheel on this one a little bit. Because, but
who am I, Jesus? Jesus,
yes.
Take the wheel.
Aren't we all?
It's true.
The scene that we see time and time again in the trailer is actually the final scene of this film.
Yeah. How disappointing was that?
I thought that was really stupid.
I thought that was really stupid, too. As soon as the first convenience store scene came around, I was like, the trailer scene's going to be the last one.
I didn't even think that. I thought it was going to happen pretty early on. Like,
I
him
think
walking
everybody
down,
thought that.
And I thought he was going to have to dip in there to grab something, and then that was just going to happen. But yeah, to
just your friendly neighborhood Venom.
Yeah.
To ostensibly show you what the ending of the movie, and I don't mean that in spoilers type way, but is a really weird way to cut a trailer, and I think that was a sign that they had not a lot to go with here.
Yeah.
And they needed to show
Well, and
whatever.
They wanted to have the Two-Face look too on the poster.
Which also,
that's like, a very good point.
Why is this the only scene where that happens then? Like, you could have just had it happen.
Because, I mean, they're probably thinking that that's the only time that he's actually truly embraced being both Eddie Brock and Venom.
But, okay, then maybe we shouldn't have even seen it in the trailer.
Probably not. But there's a fucking Pop Funko of the Hef face, so, I mean, I'm just saying, and by the way, that Pop Funko kind of sucks. So.
Yeah, I can't imagine that would be very good.
It's not.
And I say that as someone who likes Pop Funko.
I do as well. I would have bought it if it was good. Man. I've got a fucking Aquaman Pop Funko.
Hey.
It's at my office.
Oh,
I have like 15 of them. It's a problem.
That's pretty awesome.
you have more than I do, I think.
I got a Minnie Mouse Disney Infinity before all of those got discontinued. And
look
so
at you.
I have that at my desk.
Well done.
So, look at that.
Yeah.
Actually, I do have quite a few because I forgot I have a lot at work.
Mm-hmm.
No,
I have a finite amount of desk
space.
Okay,
let's really quickly go over what's on every... No, genuinely, I think this is more interesting than Venom. So, if you... Pop culture-wise, what's on your desk?
Okay, so who's going first? Me?
I have the least.
Okay,
so why don't you go first?
Okay, so I assume... Didn't mean to hit the laptop, damn.
And we are done with this episode.
This is every time, and you are literally the only person who does that.
Yeah.
So, if it makes
you
feel...
I'm so sorry.
She's like Venom. She can't control her protuberance.
I really talk with my hands. So, I assume...
The computer can tell.
Shut up.
So, I assume you guys have seen these mystery vinyl key tag things in the mystery bags. And then there's like a theme. So, like, I've seen Disney Princess ones. Well, Target, they usually have Kingdom Hearts ones.
Oh.
At my desk, I have on a little push pin hanging Axel from Kingdom Hearts because I've gotten like 2 Axels. So, like, one ended up at my desk. And then... You guys will appreciate this. I have the Avengers commemorative coin from when we saw Avengers.
Oh, that's adorable.
Opening night. Yes. So I have that at my desk, also held up by some push pins. Okay. And then, like I mentioned previously, my Minnie Mouse Disney Infinity. As far as pop culture goes, that's pretty much it. But as a gift from when I was an undergrad working on campus, I have a little like gift box thing that says Fierce and Fab, and that's it. So,
hell yeah.
Yes, my desk is
so are, by the way.
Thank you. My desk is very colorful compared to everybody else's.
Okay. So, my desk, and that's I'm just going to go from left to right here.
Okay.
Like a book. So, on my desk, a...
Lotion? Kleenex?
Not quite. Those are towards the right. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're right-handed.
That's right. Yeah. Wow. So, I actually, this is one of, it's probably my favorite thing that I have, actually, although I do like
a picture of me?
I do like my Pop Funko things I have, but a past coworker.
What's so funny about that, Anna?
A past coworker had her husband made these like metal cutouts of things. He like his, for fun, he like machined these and cut them out.
Yeah. For fun?
Yes.
Wow, he didn't do them to pass time at a boring ass job like metalworking?
No, he liked to do it. He did this at home,
that's
I guess.
Really impressive, anyway.
Yeah. Anyway, so like she like had like another coworker, she made like the Black Hawk symbol for it. Mm-hmm. And I decided to go a different direction and get something that's one of my favorite superheroes and also perfect. So I have the Iron Man head is that on my it's a magnet on my desk or one of my drawers, which is fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Perfect. Anyways, so I've got that. And then if we want to get into the Pop Funkos, and also just to set the scene, I have lots of pieces of plastic lumber on my desk creating stands for my little Pop Funko figures because I'm a child. and I do work at a plastic lumber manufacturing company. Yes.
So you're an adult.
Yeah. Believe it or not. So I have the droid from...
Rogue One.
Okay. BB-8?
No, this is K2...
Yes. K2SO.
K2SO,
yes. That's who it is.
And on the other side of that piece of plastic lumber, I have the bad BB-8 droid from The Last Jedi.
Oh, the actual evil one?
Yes, okay. The black one.
When you said bad, I'm like, well, if it's bad, why'd you get it? No, I got it.
Okay, so I have that, and then moving over next door... I have almost like a staircase made out of plastic lumber, and I have a Praetorian guard, and I have, why am I blanking on his name, the bad guy who's leading Snoke. On the bottom step, and on the top step, I have Kylo Ren, because he's above them, at least currently in the story.
Yes. May have and to change probably for around. The rest of... time.
We'll see about that until things may be changing around. But you know what? There's room
but
on...
Snoke is dead.
Is he? Don't worry. Kenny has already gotten into everything. He's like, you know who Snoke is? Snoke is the Emperor. He lived. I'm like, I hate you. If they do that, I will stop watching Star Wars.
Well, then that means they got you. Because you watched the whole trilogy.
Yeah. So I have the three of them. Okay, so now we've made it finally to my screens. Mm-hmm. So I don't have anything by my second screen, but by my main screen, which is right in the middle of my desk. On one side, I have Thor from Thor the Dark World, and on the other side, I have Thor from Infinity War with the short hair and the axe, which I thought is cool.
Is the axe the Groot axe?
Yes.
Nice.
That was the only way I would have gotten it, to be honest with you. But it's kind of cool having the both of them there. Yeah. So, and then going over to the last group I have, I have five of them stacked up on one more piece of plastic lumber. And I have the first one I ever got, which was Killer Croc from Suicide Squad.
Jesus Christ.
That's right. Nebula, then Aquaman. Gamora is
I'm assuming Aquaman modeled after the live action.
Yes.
Aquaman.
He's in like a green suit. And he's got his.
Jason Momo Aquaman.
Yes. He's got his. Trident. Yeah. Then Nebula. Then Aquaman. Then Gamora. And then randomly Ant-Man. But actually, the coolest looking Pop Funkos I have are Ant-Man and Killer Croc.
I can see that.
Yeah, I have lots of them, and it's not great.
So
but I like it.
Yeah.
So I want to say the Thor Ragnarok Funko that came out with the blue eyes, where he's like possessed. Mm. Like that was a really cool looking Funko. I really liked how that one looked.
I've gotten to the point now where, because I used to get them, and I like the droid ones I have, like. I thought they were cool, and I really just, it was an impulse buy.
Yeah.
So, but now I'm like, I really want to like what I get.
Yeah.
Like, I got the Aquaman one. Like, I almost got Dennis Nedry from Jurassic Park, the Wayne Knight character.
Love it.
And I was like, you know what? He's kind of cool, but I don't really want this. And then I saw Aquaman, and I was like, you know what? that one looks really cool, and I kind of like Aquaman, even though that movie's probably going to be shit. So
I'm excited for it.
That's
I'm
good.
Truthfully,
forward to it.
I'm really looking forward to it.
I hope it's good. I want it to be good. I am going to tell myself that it's not going to be good, so I'll be pleasantly surprised when it's mediocre.
There you go.
Yeah. So what about you, Nick? I know you've got a decent collection as well.
I do. I was actually looking for a picture to see, because I know I've taken at least one of my desks, just so I could remind myself. But I'll say this. Yes.
Okay, I just want to ask Alex very quickly,
and then
this question also is posed to you, Nick, as well. Mm-hmm. Are your Funkos out of the box?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. I throw my boxes away, too.
Yeah, I don't. Actually, a lot of Funko's boxes are in the back of my car, because it's like I'll be bringing them in, and I'll be like, I'm not going to walk in with this shit. So then I'll just take it out of the box, and then I threw it in my trunk. And now that's just become this designated. So actually, there's kind of a graveyard of boxes now, because I'm too lazy to take it out of my trunk.
Ever since I was a kid, I pretty much decided that I was never going to care about mint condition type things. I would immediately throw the box away. Because I buy these things to enjoy them, not for their resale value.
Right. That's a good point.
Yeah.
Do you still have your Funko boxes?
So, okay. At work, I don't have any Funkos, but my Disney Infinity is in the box.
Okay.
Because I think the box is cool. But I do have 3 Funkos at home, which I can get through very quickly while Nick is still finding his picture.
Okay.
And they're still all in their boxes.
By the way, this may be the nerdiest segment we have ever done.
That's why I wanted to do it.
I'm so happy to be here for it. And they're all in their boxes because I feel like it's easy to organize like that.
Okay.
Mostly for like functional purposes. That's why I like the boxes.
Okay.
And your
at-home Funkos are?
My at-home Funkos are Anders from Workaholics.
Okay.
Pixelated Batgirl.
Oh, okay.
She is pretty awesome. Hmm. And then Sailor Jupiter from Sailor Moon.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
You don't have Mr. Poopy Pants or whatever his name is?
Mr. Poopy Butthole. What? From Rick and Morty?
Yeah.
No, I'm
Every
not.
Time I see that one at Barnes & Noble, I have to laugh to myself.
Mr. Poopy Butthole. It's a good episode.
All right. So I just wanted to, like, get that out of my system, because I like do have Funkos, just not at work. So
it's cool.
Yeah, I don't think my Disney Infinity one is ever gonna go away. That's probably not worth any money, but who cares?
Yeah.
So
that's fine. If you like it,
I like
it. And it's boxed like that, then that's great.
Yeah. So I'm easily the nerdiest person at my job. So just to give you a caliber of what it's like being at my.
I like that my desk feels authentic and like my own, where everyone else's desk feels very kind of boring. Like, everyone's got, like, a photo of their family or,
right,
like, a calendar.
Yeah.
Ugh, fuck that.
I've got a photo of myself and Emily, and
I
also have a photo of Gus, but not Jock, so.
Hell yeah.
Which.
Stick it to that little cat.
Well, we didn't have Jock when I got the photo, so, you know. Mm-hmm. But at any rate, I like that my desk is, like, I feel like a child. I feel like John Lithgow in Third Rock from the Sun. He's got the Mr. Potato Head on his desk.
Yeah, it's adorable.
Yeah.
All right, Nick, after you.
So, okay. 2 things to know about my desk and my stature at work. First of all, no one's allowed near it. No.
It's going to be really awesome when they make a Pop Funko of Solo, because Nick will buy that shit day one.
I'll eat that shit.
I'm sorry.
Hey!
What? So, I'm sorry, I don't.
Oh, in the Solo film, someone has to eat shit.
Actual, yeah. It's based off of a book.
As if that makes it any better.
I'm asking because I don't know what this is. But that...
Solo is a movie that's based off the book 120 Days of Sodom by the Marquis de Sade, in which a bunch of rich aristocratic-like characters gather around a bunch of young folk, including underage children, 24 each, I think, or something like that. And gather them into their castle, and they're going to basically, for 120 days, torture, abuse, sexually assault, and do whatever they want with them. And some people hate it for obvious reasons. Some people think that it's a comment on unchecked fascism and what happens when, power corrupts with authority and whatnot. And
it is one of the more controversial films out there.
Yeah.
It sure sounds like it is.
Yeah.
So... Look it up by Pier Paolo Pasolini.
I've never watched it, and I've never had an interest in watching it.
You know, not that you should watch it or anything like that, but I definitely think it's one of the most overhyped films when it comes to, like, how much of a struggle it is to watch. I've seen much worse.
Yeah. Mm. Is it any worse than Lars von Trier films, or is it in the same kind of
ballpark?
I think
Lars von Trier is worse.
Okay.
I mean, what you're watching in Salo is, I think, surreal and kind of at a distance.
Mm.
I mean, it's atrocity, but it's like, oh, now they're just making them eat poop. Oh, now they're just having anal sex. And oh, now, like, there's just nothing. Whereas Lars von Trier mixes that kind of extremism with genuine characters, so if you're invested in the story and then they get raped, you know, I mean, that's,
yeah.
I think that's a much different thing, and I think those are harder to watch for me, personally. Mm-hmm. So, alrighty.
So, now getting to what we were actually talking
about.
Getting
to what's actually on my desk.
Yep.
So one thing about me is that once it broke in my office that I liked Audrey Hepburn, I have received a lot of Audrey Hepburn things.
Oh.
I know, right? So literally, I'm going to count those first and then move on to the Funkos. But at my desk, I have at least three pictures of her that were bought off the internet. All three of them are actually printed onto old dictionary papers. You know, like, it's like,
that's cool.
Portrait of her, you know, and
yeah.
But you know, like, on that, the back of the actual, so that way it's not just a random thing, but it's both library, it's kind of whatever.
Yeah.
I have a tin that was holding chocolate until people ate the chocolate, because I came in, and one of my best friends at work, Crystal, she got back from Italy, and she's like, oh, I brought back chocolate for everybody, and I was like, fuck you, what'd you get me? And then she was like, well, I was going to give you the tin, because, and she put the cover on, and it was Breakfast at Tiffany's. I was like, oh! So I have that tin from Italy with her on it. I have this huge canvas picture, which I actually cannot fit, so I just put it to the side of my of a shot from her at,
so iconic,
at Tiffany's. That one of my coworkers bought at a church rummage sale. But, like, clearly this is a thing around my parts. Someone gave me the sheet music that they found for Moon River, you know, the original piano score. Anyway, so I have a lot of Audrey Hepburn thing.
Mm-hmm.
I also have a poster from, like, the 90s, literally, but it's laminated, so it's survived, of when Buffy the Vampire Slayer was, like, on TV, that's got the cast, and it says, "Slay Ignorance at the Library."
Oh my god, yes.
Yes, and then I've got a bunch of figures. So Funko-wise, I have they have a different line called Adorbs, which are like the smaller, but with the round head instead of square heads.
Mm-hmm.
I have an Adorbs of Marceline from Adventure Time.
Marceline the Vampire Queen.
Yes.
Yeah.
And she is adorbs. And then the regular Funko figures I have are Cogsworth from Beauty and the Beast. I know.
Mm-hmm.
Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Lilo from Lilo and Stitch.
Nice.
Data from Star Trek The Next Generation.
Nice.
I have Jean and Tina from Bob's Burgers. I have, what else? I have a few more. I have Audrey Hepburn as Holly Golightly from Breakfast at Tiffany's. I have, you know, I'm just going to look at the picture. I have Crow T Robot and, god damn it, I'm blanking on the name and I'm very embarrassed right now because I should know this. Crow T Robot and Tom Servo from Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Oh.
And, oh, I also have a coffee mug with an Audrey Hepburn quote that was given to me and a picture of her. And I think that's probably it. But the most recent thing was I have this coworker. Oh, I also have Wally. Aw.
Aww.
That's adorable.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the most recent thing, I have a cast photo of Francis Ford Coppola's The Outsiders just hanging up there, too.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because that was, as a YA librarian, that was the first book I ever read that I loved, and that's that was actually the start of YA literature. So,
interesting.
Yes,
did not know that.
Yes, and my most recent thing is that my coworker, who really keeps to himself, so this kind of surprised me, who's just kind of a weirdo in a good way. He literally just put it on my desk and didn't tell me, so I didn't notice it for a little while. But next to Crow T Robot and Tom Servo, he put a figurine of another robot from Mystery Science Theater, Gypsy, which is not like Funko or anything, that he must have had for like years, probably like when that show was first on in the 90s. And he, I guess, doesn't want it anymore or whatever, but like he just put it down because he had told me about it one time, so I knew where it came from. So anyway, he finally found it apparently in his attic, and he brought it in and he put it next to his two buddies. So that was adorable. So basically, I had like a repository for gifts. People love to give me shit.
That is so nice. That means you are really loved at your work.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I wish I had a little bit more desk space at my work, but there's... Okay, so there's like cubicle walls. Everybody gets like their cubicle wall X amount of space. At the old building, we were allowed to like stack things on the railing of the cubicle wall, but now we're not allowed to do that. So
yeah.
I have to make do. So, I mean, it could be worse.
I have one of the bigger ones, but that was kind of like on accident because technically seniority goes in our place. But because I share my cubicle with somebody else, like we have just two people, it's me and my colleague Brandon, who's the other YA librarian, so our actual space is bigger, but we're obviously not guarded off from, well, from him at least, you know, which is totally fine with me because I'm not like jacking off at work or something. I'm just saying, like, as much as I totally get why you need privacy, like, as long as you sit with someone you like, it's not the worst thing in the world. So, anyway. But obviously, not everybody is as lucky to work with people that they like. So, right. I totally understand that, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, if you out there have any thoughts on either Venom or Pop Funkos or jacking off at work, feel free to send them on to us at filmtankshow@gmail.com.
Do you guys think I should stop doing that, by the way?
I mean, it maybe would be a good move just for keeping your job.
But Brandon's wearing headphones, so I mean...
I mean, does he cover his eyes while he's working? Or?
No, we don't face each other.
But there is still the possibility he could at some point turn around, right?
No, he's always playing Pokemon Go, so he... And that's actually a real thing that he does, like, even to this day. Yeah. I caught him the other day as I was coming back from lunch, and he was literally outside the building when he was supposed to be at the desk. This is great. I hope my boss is listening. And he was outside, you know, by the, you know, the kind of outside lobby before the inside lobby. And there was a group of people, because this actually does happen in
my-
front of our...
I want to pause really quick. My guess is because you work at a library, your location must be a gym.
We are. It's not a gym.
Or a Pokestop.
I was going to say, I think we're a Pokestop.
Okay.
And apparently there was a Mewtwo out there the other day.
Ooh.
Yes. And so I saw nine people just huddled around, and I saw him there too. And I just kind of looked, and he was like, hey. I'm like, okay. So.
Oh, God, America. We suck.
Yeah. And that was on, I told you, Alex, that was on his Pokemon Go phone. When his real phone, like, not broke, but, like, he needed a new one, he kept his old phone, and that is his
Pokemon
Go. Well,
is it like the old, like, actual video games where you lose all of your data if you...
No, it's not, because you sign in using your Google account.
It's just that way he can do that, but also have a phone.
So he could have battery life, though it doesn't get
correct.
Sucked out.
Correct. Right, like, this is only for that.
Right, exactly. So one phone is just in constant Pokemon Go mode. You don't have to switch between
apps. I mean,
apps.
That's just a smart thing to do.
That is true. Like, if you're not going to use that phone, you don't need network or whatever. But anyway, that's a real thing that's still happening in 2018.
That's all right.
Soon to be in 2019.
Oh, my God.
You know, that was, this year has been pretty much non-existent. Boy, when that, like, broke as a thing...
I was obsessed.
You and everybody else, and I was horrified that that was going to actually
Yeah, you were,
be
like, outraged.
I was.
I just remember, like, for the first
week. Because you couldn't fucking drive anywhere. You had to look out for goddamn people
Alex,
walking
in
the street.
Dating yourself like nobody's business right now. Those fucking kids won't just get out of my way while they're playing Pokemon Go.
But actually, there were people just walking through the street being like, where is it?
That's what you thought, but that's not. No, you were like, you were very much get off my lawn. Yeah.
Yeah. I also don't like Pokemon.
So
that doesn't help either. But at the same time, no, it was ridiculous.
I mean, I didn't play it, and I never have, but I also was like, oh.
I played it, and I loved it.
I was like, look at people.
You still play it, don't you?
I don't play it, actually. You don't play it. I stopped playing it less than a year.
When you got out of rehab.
I stopped playing it less than a year after it came out because...
You shouldn't have brought that up.
I started...
Whoops.
I started listening to podcasts instead. So
that makes sense.
Yeah. That was just better to not always...
You know what?
Yeah.
I do go in phases, though. I did play the new Animal Crossing game.
I did play that, too.
For, like, a long time.
Yeah.
I still pretty much have it on my phone. I don't think I've checked it in, like, a month or two.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I probably could get sucked back into it.
Yeah.
But there was a time when I was tap, tap, tapping a Rooney.
I know. Animal Crossing was so good, too.
It is.
But,
it
like,
still is. It just,
I think a few months into Animal Crossing, I kept, like, literally, I was just laying down and playing it, and then I was like, I really should, like, exercise.
Well, the worst part about Animal Crossing for me was that it had been out for a couple weeks, and I don't do mobile games, so I'm like, oh, I don't need that in my life, even though I love Animal Crossing.
Right, yeah.
But I was like, it was Thanksgiving, so I was like, oh, I'm just gonna download this and pass the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then I woke up, and I had a gun in my hand, and a bag of Coke at my feet, completely used, and man, that game was not great to me.
So, this has nothing to do with what you're talking about.
What?
But I'm reading something right now.
I want to talk about this.
It's going to be very dated, probably. Anyways, I just read that the new Rian Johnson film, which people are interested in a lot, called Knives Out, which is going to come out next year, which has already Chris Evans and Daniel Craig in it, apparently is also going to have Michael Shannon, and I am interested.
I will never forget when I listened to your guys' Sundance episode how badly you made fun of Michael Shannon, and ever since then,
well-deserved.
That has colored my perception of him.
He's a fun actor.
He actually is a very eccentric person.
I believe it.
Who could easily just have been a crazy homeless person. If acting wouldn't have worked out, I don't think there's a different outcome there would have been.
Well, good for him that he's not a crazy homeless person, and I mean, giving us art all day.
He is a true actor artist. Like, he is fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
He
I like him too.
He just puts on just the most delightfully obnoxious performances, and they are just delightful. So there's a storm coming. That was an okay movie.
I thought that movie.
I was a little overrated, but that's all right. I know you really liked it. So, on our next episode, we are going to be talking about Bad Times at the El Royale.
Hell yeah.
Which is the new film from Drew Goddard, who previously directed Cabin in the Woods. So, interesting to see what this ends up being. Definitely looks like a fun little ensemble film, and I'm not exactly sure what the storyline's gonna end up being, but all I know is that the trailer has shots of Jeff Bridges as a priest, and also Jeff Bridges basically looking like one of the clowns who was part of the robbery at the beginning of The Dark Knight, and I'm fucking down for that.
Me too.
So,
I'm very pumped.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, this doesn't need to be said on the podcast, but I'm going to say it anyway. Next week, because we always record and then sometimes watch a movie, can we watch the movie Identity?
What is that?
That is the thriller from, like, a while ago, maybe over a decade ago, done by the guy who's now famous, James Mangold. Where 10 strangers show up to a motel in the middle of the night, and they all have secrets. And
oh, yeah, we can.
John Cusack.
Yeah.
John McGinley.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, it's got a very random cast. Jake Busey.
Oh.
Ray Liotta. So.
Oh, Ray Liotta.
Yes.
Have you seen the new Shantix commercials with Ray Liotta, by
the
way?
Yes, I have.
Because they are awful.
They are.
It is great.
Yeah.
I had such a hard time when I was on set trying to read scripts until I got Shantix. The fuck?
Good for you, Ray Liotta.
I was going to say, He's been trying for 30 years to find a role that'll make people like him again, but he still just can't.
Yeah.
Another film I've been meaning to watch recently that I've been interested in seeing is the Coen Brothers film, The Man Who Wasn't There.
Yeah, I've been wanting to watch that.
That getting Netflix release?
No.
That's
an old film of theirs from like 2000 with Billy Bob Thornton. They are doing a movie called the Ballad of Buster.
That's the one. Gags. Forgive
or
me.
Scoggs or
Buster Scruggs, I think.
Something like that. Yeah. And that is going straight to Netflix, I think.
Yeah.
That doesn't really bode well for it being good.
Not just straight to Netflix, but it was actually supposed to be a show. Like, they were going to do an anthology show. And then what they decided to do was take different threads, because it turned out to be an anthology movie, and they just made, like, a movie instead of drawing out.
Boy.
So it's going to be, like, short story.
Ooh, anthology movies could go bad really quickly.
Could, but I like them.
Depends how it's done.
Yeah.
One of the most interesting anthology films I've ever seen was the pretty highly regarded film Paris.
Gentlemen?
Yep.
Oh, I liked that one a lot.
I was a little lukewarm on it.
I mean, I'm sure it was better than the New York version that came out not too long afterward.
It was just, I don't know. I mean, that's the problem, is that, like, there were good parts of it, but at the same time, I was just like, okay.
I feel like I've seen a lot of anthologies, but then I realized that that's one of the more popular format for horror films.
Yeah.
You know, that's very common in that genre, especially back in the 70s when they would basically just take movies that didn't make it to theater. For example, there's one called Night Train to Terror, which is very bad and awesome at the same time. And they basically took three movies that never made it to theaters because they were that bad, and they came up with a new framing structure where it was God and the devil were playing or talking on a train, and they have to determine whether these three people will go to heaven or hell. And that meant nothing in the grand scheme of things, because then all that would happen was, like, the 30 minutes worth of footage from these three different films would just play randomly. It's actually pretty great, actually. So, anyway. Also, I've been meaning to watch this anthology film from, like, 18 years ago called Eros Massacre, because the three directors, there's supposed to be three films about love in some way, kind of like Paris, are Soderbergh, Wong Kar-wai, and I think Michelangelo Antonioni, the famous Italian filmmaker who's fantastic. So that's like a just fucking Avengers style team of directors.
Fun fact before we finish, I think we can all notice that this Venom poster doesn't have the spider logo on his chest. It's because Sony does not have the rights to that.
That would be correct. They made
why
an original logo for him.
Spider logo.
Because
he does
in the
comics.
I mean, like, why though? Why?
Because in the comics,
he works with Peter Parker.
Correct.
I think Peter Parker.
Why would he put a spider? He's not a spider person.
But why? In the comics,
explain this.
In the comics, whoa. Peter Parker Jesus. Becomes. I think in the comics, from what I understand, Venom finds Peter Parker first, and thus getting the spider on his chest. Because for a short time, Peter Parker...
Oh, you mean the symbiote.
The symbiote finds
Peter Parker
him.
Was Venom for a short
For a very
time.
Short time. That's what I was told.
Okay.
This was information told to me.
Interesting.
So, and then when Eddie Brock becomes Venom...
I'll go with it.
Yeah. So, hence, you know, more legality... in absence of this film and also this poster.
Not surprising.
So yeah. Did that mean that that tongue belongs to Peter Parker too?
I don't know. Maybe you should ask.
Maybe I will.
We'd have to spend a lot of time on this. But how does Sony have the rights to Spider-Man but not Venom? Since Venom's in the Spider-Man universe.
That's a very good question. You got to ask some lawyers about that.
How does Sony have the rights to Spider-Man?
No, like how do they have the... How does... like sorry... How does Sony still have the rights to Venom even though they no longer have the rights to Spider-Man?
I'm sure that was negotiated somehow because Sony still owns Peter Parker. So Sony, like the rumor was that Peter Parker was going to show up in this movie, but then he didn't. because Sony owns. See,
maybe
Alex is like
off,
so overwhelmed by this dumb bullshit.
Maybe selling off Peter and Spider-Man to the MCU. Like, they were like, but we still want to be able to use Spider-esque
exactly
people.
Right. And so,
in case we want to make our shitty Andrew Garfield movies or whatever. And so,
but they can make it because they have Spider-Man. They don't have the glue that's holding this universe together.
I'm not saying it's a good idea.
I do wonder if when Spider-Man was allowed to be used, I wonder if Disney paid for Venom to be made.
Well, in the titles of the movie, we see that it says in association with Marvel Pictures, so...
Well, no, but that's because Marvel's, but I guess I'm saying more of like a, give us Spider-Man and here's $50 million for your little Venom project.
That's a possibility.
Like it's like a, like they're not
that's
producing
what I mean.
It. It's mm-hmm. just like
that's
off the books.
I thought. Yeah. Well, like, we get this back and you can have this piece of shit. A turd and a wind in the wind.
And a turn with the
turd
wind. Turd with the wind.
Oh, I thought you said turd in the wind.
I thought that's what you said.
No, well, I mean, I was
fart in the
struggling
wind
a little bit.
Fart
there
in the wind.
He says turd in the wind in the movie.
Does he really?
Doesn't he?
I don't remember this.
I thought he was saying to the guy in the convenience shop that he was like, and
yes,
you're going to see me and you're
going
to cower and you're going to run away. And he's like a turd in the wind.
Yeah. Headless, legless, turd in the wind.
Yes.
Nope. You're okay. Right.
He says that because
that's right.
Either
right
Vulture or somebody, Variety, used, it basically said Venom is a turd in the wind. And so, of course, at first we were like, that's really stupid writing. But then you see the movie and you're like, oh, I see what they did there.
So, thank you very much to Anna Bodizadu for joining us here on this episode. Really good luck with your upcoming haircut.
Thank you. And thank you again for having me. It's always a blast being here.
Yeah. Absolutely. Let us know how
please
it goes.
Absolutely.
And look forward to getting together with you in a month or two for another episode.
Can't wait.
All right. So from Anna, Nick, myself, Alex Diekman, thank you very much for listening to us here at Film Tank. We'll be catching up with you next time.